You're listening to IRN, the Inception Radio Network, Chicago, Illinois.
Extraordinary Phenomenon Investigations Council presents Epic Voyages. Come join us as we enter and experience the great mysteries of the world with tonight's host,
Laurel Blythe Tague. Welcome, everybody, to Epic Voyages Online Radio tonight here on Inception Radio Network. I am Laurel Tag. I am your host for this evening, and we have a great show tonight, very interesting show. I'm going to be talking to one of my co-hosts here on Epic Radio, Lois Wetzel, and Lois has just released her latest book of case studies and other transcriptions of past life readings from the Akashic Record. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Let's see. First of all, I want to mention our website for epicvoyagers.com. And we have a YouTube channel. If you go to YouTube and put in Epic Voyagers, hundreds of hours of videos, presentations from people whose names you'll remember, you'll recognize, including Jim Mars, who was just on here with it just left my brain. Jerry Pippin. Sorry, Jerry. Also, our show is rebroadcast on Fridays on Dark Matter Radio Network. You can check it out there, and we'll be archived here along with all our other shows that have been archived since 2011 at Inception Radio Network, probably sometime over the weekend. So, as I'm saying, we have on line with us tonight Lois Wetzel, author of her newly released book, Reincarnation, Past Lives, and the Akashic Records. This is Lois's second book about past lives, and this one is discussing the impact of what even one past life can have on many, many subsequent lifetimes, and possibly even on lifetimes of your descendants. Old traumas and tragedies can be the underlying causes for current life maladies and unhappiness, loneliness, neuroses. Understanding the root causes can bring about recovery or resolution. If you read her earlier book, The Akashic Records, Case Studies of Past Lives, you have a sense of the kinds of case studies and descriptions that she includes in great detail. Lois herself is a Reiki master teacher. She's a professional certified level body talk practitioner, a trained and practicing shaman, and an advanced facilitator of Psych-K. She's the founder of Adena Energy Medicine, a healing technique that's based in ancient practice across many cultures. And she also writes for Sedona Journal magazine under the pen name Lotus Fire. And if you don't know, her website is Hot Pink Lotus, all one word, no spaces, .com. We'll be posting web links up in the chat room here at Inception Radio. If you want to join us in the chat room, it'll be a lively 2 hours. We'll probably take a break somewhere around, 5 or 10 minutes before the hour. And after that, I guess we're just going to launch into it. Lois, how are you doing tonight?
Well, I'm doing quite well. How about you?
Well, I'm sitting here looking at snow accumulating, and the last weather report and weather bug alert I got said that by Friday, we might have experienced 3 to 5 inches of snow per hour at times, and up to 3 feet or more accumulation, and gusts of up to 45 miles an hour. So welcome to Western New York.
Jiminy crickets.
Only the hardy.
Going to build an igloo?
What? I ought to build an igloo.
Yeah. You are come on down to Houston. I don't think it's going to happen here.
Oh, no, but I'm from Dallas, and my dad's keeping me posted, and they've been in the 20s, which is just unheard of in November.
Yeah, we've had it down into the, it got down into the 30s at night, but today it was nice and warm and 50 degrees, and the sun was out. I was just tickled. It was really great.
You're so close to the Gulf there. I would imagine some of the heat that comes off the Gulf of Mexico will help you guys out, and it might not make it up towards North Texas. So
yeah, and those upper cold drafts always arc and stop short of us.
Yeah,
they get Dallas, but not Houston.
Now Lois is going to be hosting here. Actually, you're on the schedule for not next week, but December the 1st. Do you have a guest yet?
I do. I have one lined up. I'm trying to get a second one for the second hour. And the first one is Dana Taylor, who's written a book called Everflowing Streams, which is about energy medicine.
Oh.
She's a winner, one of the winners of the the Indie Spiritual Book Awards competition, and in the energy medicine category. Mm-hmm. And it's a really awesome book. And it's the beauty of it is this book is a bridge between people who are who were raised in Christianity in a way that makes them kind of afraid of the metaphysical. And she creates this gorgeous bridge because she was raised an agnostic and became a Christian as an adult. And she makes it all make sense because she can see both sides of the metaphysics and the Christianity. And she makes it, she's created language that makes it easier for people to bridge that gulf.
And this being an indie book, is this one of those that we have to go, where would you find that online?
Well, just like my book's an indie book, it's Amazon and Kindle.
Okay.
Amazon is the best friend an indie author ever had.
Okay.
I mean, they treat us like gold. They treat us, every one of us, like we're just as important as the biggest publishing house.
Well, I know I've read both of your books, I highly recommend anyone. And you've got 4 books out. 2 of them have to do with the Akashic Records. And what are the other 2 books?
Well, the other two, one is about the Adena energy medicine. Mm-hmm. And it's about how that came to me and how certain spiritual beings who are associated with and evolved from a planet on the Sirius B star system came and spoke to me telepathically to show me how to put together some old things from that once upon a time were known on Earth, healing modalities. And then they channeled to me the ones that had been completely lost. Some of them had been saved in different cultures or bits and pieces in different cultures all over the planet, in Native American cultures, bits from there and bits from China and from many different cultures, Egypt. But there were pieces that were completely lost that they channeled to me, and those have all been woven together in a series of classes. And mostly we heal with etheric light and it's fast and it's profound. Anybody interested in energy medicine should go look at Edina Energy Medicine from the Stars. And I explain, you know, how I was doing Reiki session, which is also energy medicine, which is also channeling light that's not in the visible range, and you can feel it as heat usually or buzzing. I was doing that kind of session, and I kept seeing beings in the room, and they were, you know, in my mind's eye, I could see them, and they were suddenly appeared one day, tall, blue, skinny beams of light that went up through the ceiling, and I perceived them as being about 15, 20 feet tall. Mm. And then one day I just sort of said, in my mind, I thought, I wonder what that is. And they answered me instantly. Boom. They told me their name. And I said, where are you from? And they told me where they were from. And I went, oh, okay. And I finished what I was doing, you know, and they started coming back periodically when I was doing sessions. And I would ask them questions, and finally, they began working with me and suggesting things for me to do in the session, and it unfolds from there. And so then another book is, and that one was Edina Energy Medicine from the Stars.
Okay.
And another book is Sacred Journeys and Vision Quests. That was my third book. And that's about mystical events which have happened to me and other people who were with me in over a 40-year period. And it's kind of written like a diary in a way. I put the date, you know, and then an entry and tell them what happened that day. Sometimes at Mount Shasta, sometimes when, like, for example, at Mount Shasta once, I met a man who walked up to me and said, do you remember me? And I said, I don't think we've met. And I thought, that's a great pickup line, dude. And he said, no, I was your general. And I said,
what? Oh, my goodness.
You were my what? He said, don't you remember me? I was Gilles Derat. And I went, no, I never heard that name before. And he went on to tell me that I had been in, you know, running an army, and he was one of my generals. And I'm like, oh, okay. And I didn't kind of, I really didn't. It was about a year before I really put it all together and went, he might be right. And then there were other events about, Now, this book, this show is about reincarnation, but we're talking about some of the other books I've written, and it's a two-hour show. If you hang in there, we will get to reincarnation. But so this is like the stories in the book are about things like the events that happened to me when I was in Bosnia, for example, at the pyramids, things that happened to other people as well, strange things happen in those tunnels and so on. And so that's the kind of thing that is in that particular book. Strange things that happened when my kids were in the car or on the top of a pyramid in Mexico and that sort of thing. Mm. And yeah, bizarre.
And these are all at Amazon.com.
All at Amazon.com. And if you just type my name in, Lois J. Wetzel, in the search, all the books will come up under that.
Okay, great.
All four of them.
Great.
So the most recent book that just came out on Kindle September the 9th is my second book on reincarnation. And the title is Reincarnation, Past Lives and the Akashic Record. And it's primarily like the first book in so far as I do tell a lot of people's case studies. Like when I do a full reading for someone, between four and six lifetimes usually come up. Mm-hmm. And I report all of them in the full case studies. But this time I also cherry picked from about five different people a single past life that just had a profound effect on them. Mm-hmm. And explained a whole lot of things. And I also talk about how quantum physics and mechanics figure into explaining how we, and some other scientific things that have happened, like things that happen when people die and then come back into their bodies and things they've seen and report that they couldn't and heard that they couldn't have because they were dead. But these single individual stories of people's past lives are like, this is the one that fascinates me the most. Do you want me to tell you that story?
Hold on to it for just a second. Before we get started on specific stories, I just want to give a little bit of a lead in here to this whole topic. I have been hooked on this issue of past lifetimes and reincarnation since the early 70s. I first read Jess Stern's book, The Search for the Girl with Blue Eyes. And he also wrote books about Taylor Caldwell, a famous author, all of her past lives. And he wrote books about Edgar Cayce. And as you were saying, you read the Akashic Records. You actually access the information there like it's a database or a library. Yeah. And then you narrate that in great detail to the person that you're reading for. And if I'm not wrong, you not only see as if you're reading, but you hear and you feel and you smell and everything, right?
Exactly. It's like I'm right there.
Well, Ken, for people that may not be, I mean, I never know if our listeners have really been as completely absorbed in a topic that I'm this interested in. Why don't you say a little bit, explain for people what, in real simple terms, what are the Akashic Records?
The Akashic Records are a storehouse of everything that ever happened to anybody on the earth ever, no matter how far back in history it was. Everything, including parallel lifetimes, which I get into in the book as well, an explanation of that. It's like a massive, when I see it, it looks like a cloud nebula away from the earth. I'm not sure exactly where it is, but I float into that and then start seeing all of this like a movie. Jews refer to the Akashic Records. They've got a different name for it. They call it the Book of Life. Many cultures all over the planet have always talked about this record, and they talk about it in many different ways, but as far back as short though it may be, our recorded history goes compared to how long ago we've actually been here, they almost all cultures have some reference to the fact that everything is recorded somewhere. So some people are born with, we all know there are musicians, gifted musicians. We all know there are gifted artists. We know there are, you know, gifted mathematicians. I just have a gift that has to do with being able to float up into that cloud and see a movie and also talk about it at the same time.
And it's like a three-dimensional, completely sensory surround movie.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
By the way, is why I can only do a certain number of them, because it's exhausting.
That's just what I was going to say, that you have told me before that, and not all of these are happy, fun lifetimes, and you do take a little bit of an empathic toll by witnessing disturbing things, but even if it's not disturbing, it's still exhausting because it's almost like being there yourself.
What we know about the brain and the body now is that anything you think or even feel or pretend might as well be happening to you. Mm-hmm. For the way your body reacts. So I can't do that many of them. Yeah, this is the same way Edgar Cayce did them, I think. I mean, because I never, I was very careful until about two, and I've been doing this for over 20 years, and until 2 years ago, I was very careful not to read how anybody else did past life readings. And then, you know, 2 years ago, I was out in the woods trying to recuperate from overwork, and picked up in a used bookstore nearby a book about how Edgar Cayce did his readings, and I was just totally shocked that I did them exactly the same way, and I thought my students and I were the only ones who could do that. And I do train people how to do this. I have trained a few people, and I'm planning to train more.
Well, that's good news. That's very good news. And I guess if we went to your website, pinklotus.com, we could keep up with you on that development.
If you sign up for that newsletter, for sure, that's okay. The best way. But that is where I will announce it when I'm ready to teach the classes. I've got some other things I need to complete before I do that. Relocation and so on. But I go in, and I was talking to a guy that I was interviewing on one of my blog talk radio shows back when I did that, Michael Hathaway, who's written several of the Everything books, and he wrote a book called Everything You Need to Know About Past Lives or something like that. Anyway, Michael Hathaway is his name, and he said that people usually do one or the other. When they're regressed, they either actually experience it, or they in it, or they're outside it looking at it. But he said from forth, I'm in it, immersed in it, and then I step out and look at it. So verb tenses change, which really annoyed people in my first book. So I tried not to have so many verb. I got tired of the bad reviews about verb changes because some people are nitpickers. So I tried.
Well, it's just not enough for you to be reading these records of something that happened thousands of years ago. You've got to get your verb tenses straight.
That's how I felt about it. I felt like saying the blank you words at them. But.
Okay, we're not going to go there tonight.
it was hard already. What about my verb tenses? Jeepers.
Tell me something, and I have my own opinion about this, but why do you think an individual would or should research his or her own past lifetime? Why would you say someone should do that?
Well, I would phrase it differently. I don't ever tell anybody what they should. I try really hard not to ever say what they should do, but here is why some people do it. Mm-hmm. Some people choose to do it because they have an intractable illness that no one can figure out the cause of it. And they've tried everything under the sun, and they decide that they read the book or the friend tells them, we'll try it and see if this works. And, you know, I do a reading for them that explains what happened and the guilt that they have from that lifetime, or the experience somehow is re-triggered in an experience now. And when they hear about what happened in that lifetime, begins to heal. Mm-hmm. And the reason that it does is because, same reason in psychology, when you uncover in therapy a buried memory, everything that's connected to it, whether it's personality traits, physical illness, relationship issues, will heal when you uncover the buried memory, and it happens gradually. It is not a boom overnight thing. It may take weeks, months, years. I'll give you an example of one person got a past life reading, and she got several, and she had benefits, and she knew it. And 5 years later, she wrote me to tell me that she had just listened to the reading again and realized that she'd had recurring fever blisters around her mouth all her life, starting when she was like in her early 20s, and she was in her 50s. And she also had a tendency to scream at people. I mean, not even, she'd be yelling and not know she was yelling. When I did this particular past life reading where someone had kidnapped her and sewn her mouth shut to keep her quiet because she was screaming because she was being kidnapped. And there were many other things that were related to that past life that she knew about that we figured out, but she did not realize until 5 years later that coincidentally that was when her fever blister stopped happening. Mm-hmm. And over a gradual period of time, she had stopped screaming at people. She was just very calm.
There are, it's amazing to me within the last couple of years how many, sometimes they're shows, sometimes they're movies, sometimes they're one-off kind of documentaries, but how many times there are things we can watch, especially on the cable channels, about people who are spontaneously remembering past lifetimes. I'm thinking right now of a cable TV show called The Ghost Inside My Child, and it's all about children and the parents having to go through, well, what am I supposed to do with this? And there's a famous case of a little boy who knew tons of detail about World War II airplanes and fighter planes, and turns out they could actually verify eventually that he was this particular individual who crashed, and he even had memories of some of his not his crew, because his crew went down with him, but some of the other men that were in his close-knit unit, and they met. I mean, that's pretty remarkable stuff.
Yeah, the name of the ship was Natoma Bay, and the current lifetime kid's name is James Leninger. I can't remember the name of James was his name when he was shot down at Midway Island. But I mentioned that in the book, and if you want to go look at the YouTube of that, it's absolutely fascinating. Just
He was actually on that Ghost Inside My Child show too recently, but there is an hour-long show I think that's been dedicated to it. And you do these readings remotely. What do you need for a trigger, and why do you do it remotely instead of in the presence of the people that you're reading for?
Well, most of the people I read for aren't anywhere near me.
Okay.
But it's easier on me if they're not physically present, wiggling and asking questions and making noises and all that. I go deeper into the trance, and I don't come in and out, and that's really hard on my body, in and out, in and out. So I do them all remotely. Now, I used to do them in person for 15 years at least. But what the trigger is, I have them send readings for people in Australia and Europe and South Africa and everywhere, you know, and I'm in Texas. So it's just physically not possible to do them all in person. But
that makes sense.
They send me a photograph with their eyes open, not wearing sunglasses, because they get it sent back if they're wearing sunglasses or making stupid faces. I try to word that gently, but sometimes young people make goofy faces. I need to look into their eyes, you know, which are indeed the windows of the soul. And then I give them the opportunity to ask three questions, like, why do I have such a horrible addiction to alcohol? Or why do I keep being attracted to women who are unavailable? Or, you know, why do I have a recurring problem with, you know, X, Y, or Z? You know, whatever their issue is. And they can ask up to three questions. And if they're asking one of the questions, like, who is so-and-so to me? Like, have I had a past life with daughter or my, you know, ex or whatever? Then I can, you know, that can come through. And I like them to send me a picture of that person, too. But if they can't, that'll still come through. And it's looking into the client's eyes. And it has to be somebody over the age of 18. Only in a dire emergency would I open the records. I've only done it like twice. Open the records for someone under the age of 18. And that would be when a past life is bleeding through and taking over the current lifetime.
That's scary.
Well, it can be. And of course, there are a lot scarier things than that, but I mean, in the world. But yeah, there was a young woman who, she was like 16 or 17, and her mother asked permission, and I asked the guardians of the Akashic Records, and I said, yes, you can. And it was a young girl who, and not all past life memories are about famous people, certainly, but this happened to be the singer Edith Piaf had reincarnated as a girl here in Texas, actually. And she's mentioned in my first book, Akashic Records, the one with the green cover. When you get there to the Amazon, it's the green cover. And she had been told by someone she was Edith Piaf reincarnated. So she goes and reads about Edith Piaf, and then it starts blowing through. And Edith Piaf had a horrible problem with addictions. Mm-hmm. And she was, you know, the little girl was like not doing drugs, but she was being overwhelmed emotionally by this and not functioning very well. And so I had to go in and learn as much as I could about further details and hear information from the guardians of the records, what more she needed to know to benefit from that lifetime so that she would not be negatively impacted. And then four other lives, and one of them was just really beautiful, extraordinary lifetime. Well, I can just get distracted into everybody's stories.
Let me interrupt you for a second, Lois. I want to make sure everybody, we've been talking already for over half an hour. I want to remind everyone that you're listening to Epic Voyages Radio here on Inception Radio Network, and we're talking with Lois Wetzel, the author of several books. Her latest one that was just released a couple of months ago, Reincarnation, Past Lives, and the Akashic Records. And Lois, I've got all kinds of questions here come in from the chat room. So if you don't mind, I'm going to interrupt my question list and you for a second and get to some of these questions. Is that okay?
Okay.
Okay. These are some pretty good questions too. One of the really recent ones that just came in, one of the problems with reincarnation is that a lot of people struggle with where are all these new souls coming from? How would you address that?
Well, I'm not sure what that has to do with reincarnation, but I know, okay, we're being, why are there so many people on the planet? Is that what's
meant? I think that might be, I mean, is it like a finite set of individuals, I'm guessing. The person in the chat room that wrote that, if you want to add some detail to that question,
Let me go ahead and answer what I think's relevant, and then if she or he has more to ask. First of all, what I've seen and what a lot of other people have seen is that there are constantly new souls being born, and they're born in, again, star nebulae or something that looks like star nebulae. And they are nurtured and grown and taken to many different planets, many different locations, and many of them come here. So they're constantly being born. And so, of course, and then when they come to Earth, this is one of the choices souls can make. Hang on a second. Mm-hmm. This is a choice that souls can make, and they evolve by incarnating over and over and over and over again and grow and grow and grow and grow at differing speeds. Some of us learn faster than others. And eventually they evolve to a place where they don't come back into physical incarnation anymore. And what they become, I don't know. It's above my pay grade. So that's why new ones are always being born. And you want to talk a minute while I get
something? Yes, I will. I have the same. That's what my little mute button here on my headset is for. These are two questions, but they're kind of getting to the point I was going to ask you about next in my notes. Does reincarnation follow a linear timeline, or is it possible to be reincarnated into a time that's in the past or in the future in relation to your current life? And is it possible for anyone to live the same life? More than one people sharing the experience of the same life, I think is what this question means.
Well,
So one is about the linearity of timelines and life's proceeding along a linear timeline. And the other is it possible for someone to live the same life more than once, or two people to share an experience in one lifetime?
Oh, I think I know where that's coming from. Okay, okay. Say, for example, six people are Joan of Arc. I think that's where this is coming from. Or five people say they were Marie Antoinette.
Okay.
That's parallels. Those are parallel lifetimes. We're getting, okay. After parallel lifetimes, so say you make a major decision in this lifetime and it branches off, and then there are two of you because one of you made this decision and the other made the other decision. And so there are people who think, I don't think I agree with it, but I think there are people who think that in the different dimensions, these people have different souls.
Oh, okay. It's a lot of theory and conjecture about how it works that really is very difficult to, I'm going to use a word, a scientific word here, prove. I mean, you can have a really strong hunch that you know the way it works, but there's so much conjecture out there, and I think that's where a lot of people get into endless debates about how this works or that works or what doesn't even work at all. Here's a good question that I think I know the answer to. Can our dreams of unknown locations or persons be related to things that we experienced in a past life?
Well, sometimes you're dreaming about, not going to go there again, going to get dragged off into a completely different area about metaphysics and explaining how all that works. It can be. A lot of people have very profound, deep, realistic dreams, which they feel like they were really, really there. And that is very frequently a past life experience of spontaneous past life memory. And if you have real strong emotions associated to it and you keep thinking about it all day and maybe even the next day and the day after that, it's highly likely that was a past life memory and it's come up to heal you.
Mm-hmm. Well, since you're talking about that and then you're asking about parallel lives, my next question for you was overlapping and parallel lives, and even what happens to you in between this life and the next one. Have you seen examples of any kind of those?
Yeah, they're all over the place. There, and that I mentioned parallel lifetimes in and talk about them in the book. And then Michael Newton's got a book that's all about where souls go in between lifetimes. And as many people as he interviewed, you know, that all told the same story, basically. It's kind of like, how can you doubt it when total strangers say the same thing, you know, under hypnosis? So, yeah.
Okay. In my opinion, the idea of karma goes hand in hand with the idea of reincarnation, and that you reap what you sow. The good and the bad you create in life definitely comes back to you eventually. And this latest book of yours, and I want to be real honest about this, impresses me a lot because of the way that you discuss certain things about what I think most people think of as karma. And I'm specifically talking about your discussions of the role of forgiveness and compassion. And I want to read, this isn't a direct quote from the book, it may be a paraphrase, but one of the things that you say in your book that I think is really, really powerful is that you came to a point where you decided that you would no longer allow yourself to be held hostage in your own self and your own soul and your own heart by what some other person did to harm you. And I think that that whole concept about forgiving, I mean, I got to tell you, forgiving and forgetting has been a major issue my whole life and probably will continue to be. And that's a very complicated issue, I think, because how can you forget if it's so awful that it's really hard to forget it or forgive it? But can you say something about this idea about you holding yourself hostage by not forgiving?
Yeah, what happens is the more you think about, well, forgiving and forgetting are two different things. It's really impossible to make yourself forget. In fact, it might not be good to make yourself forget. Mm-hmm. That way you don't fall into that trap ever again with another person. However, forgiving doesn't mean saying that what they did was okay. Forgiving means that you're no longer mulling it over, being angry, releasing chemicals that come from anger inside your body to attack yourself. Sorrow does the same thing. Anything you refer to as negative emotions, anything that isn't based in love, is destructive to your body down to the cellular level. And you are re-traumatizing yourself and giving that person all your power by dwelling on what they did. So what forgiveness is saying, enough already. I'm going to let go of what you did so that I don't continue to re-traumatize myself by dwelling on and gnawing on what you did. I'm taking my power back. I'm letting go away emotionally, and I'm not going to tell anybody else stories about it, and I'm not going to chew on it, and I'm not going to think about it. I'm going to let it go, and that is called forgiveness. You do it for yourself, not the other person. You do it for yourself.
I do know that when something happens that really, really hurts and traumatizes you, that if you continue to obsess on it and dwell on it and think about it and bring it up in conversation and kind of treat yourself like you have this tender spot that just should never be touched, that's like battery acid. It really has the same effect as battery acid on your soul, I think. At least that's been my experience when I've done that.
Yeah, it's got battery acid effect on your body too. Mm. You know, you won't live as long. And we do carry those resentments and hatreds forward. And that is mm-hmm. that is how you, if you want to keep reincarnating with that person over and over and over again, you just keep being angry at them and you don't forgive them. That's how you keep coming back and doing it again and again and again until you get the lesson of forgiveness. Because forgiving somebody, moving on and feeling the love that comes when you're finally able to put yourself in their position, which sounds impossible until you decide you're going to move on, and then you go, well, you know, maybe if that person had not had that childhood or whatever, and you begin to put yourself into their shoes, then you can begin to feel compassion for them. Compassion is a function of love. And when you can do that, you don't have to come back with that person again.
I'll tell you what, if you've ever had someone in your life that you felt really, really brutalized you, the last thing in the world that you ever want to do is come back and go through anything with that person again. So that alone is a perfect argument for figuring out how to forgive and let go of that. If no other reason sounds good, that to me is a very good reason. Another thing you said in your book, and I thought this was very interesting, you made a point of saying that there are two really great transgressions that a person can make. One is violating another person's free will, and the other is mocking another person, especially at the moment of his or her death. Say something about both of those.
Okay, let's say the mocking thing first, mocking someone at the moment of death. My understanding from the Guardians of the Records, and also Edgar Casey got the same thing, is that, well, the moments of birth and death are the most intense on the soul. They mark the soul the most deeply. And at the moment of death, if someone is watching you die and making fun of you, it makes a really painful mark on you. And for that reason, they may come back with a disability what you're going through is born with a humpback, and they're dying, and somebody's kicking them and making fun of them and laughing at their, oh, look at the humpback die, you know, and making fun of the humpback. They may come back with scoliosis or a humpback or whatever, you know, something similar. And that's not saying everybody with scoliosis, you know, had that experience, but that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So, which is interesting, I think. And, you know, throughout history, particularly in the darker periods of time, I think people were more likely to do that. Although, I suppose in some pretty vicious situations like what's going on with ISIS, they may also be doing that. Mm-hmm. So, the other question, I'm sorry, was?
Let's see. I think it was about violating someone's free will. That was the other great transgression. Violating another person's free will.
Are you sure that's exactly how I put it?
I almost took it verbatim. I usually have the page number down here, and I didn't do it this time, but you said violating another person's free will is one of the greatest transgressions. And then the next paragraph you were talking about mocking them at the moment of their death. So,
well, I'm pretty sure that this was the sovereignty of the soul. In other words, mm-hmm. For example, if people who do spiritual healing sometimes think that they know what's best for the other person. Mm-hmm. I'll give this as an example. Mm-hmm. And everybody who does things like spiritual healing, for example, they're all taught to ask the other person if it's okay to work on them, mm-hmm. either in person or at a distance. And people who think they know what the other person needs and work on them and heal them, for example, if somebody were to draw a Reiki symbol on someone else's back across the room in a restaurant because they think that's what that person needs because they're fighting with their spouse, that's violating the free will of that person's soul because they didn't get permission to do it, and the soul may have a reason for that person to be fighting with their spouse in the restaurant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sounds like interference and intrusion to me.
It is, very much so, because you don't know what that soul has in mind for that person as part of their learning process, and their whole learning process is evolution toward becoming that something else that is the goal that means you don't come back and incarnate anywhere again. Mm-hmm. So interference with that is interfering with the soul's plan for that person is a real travesty. That's kind of like in the Akashic Records for somebody without their permission. It's mm-hmm. a horrible violation. You have
Go ahead.
You have no right to open the Akashic Records for somebody or even do a reading for somebody. If you can do tarot readings, for example, and you are psychic readings, and you walk up to somebody and you know, a lot of people who do this usually like touch you, go, oh, I have something to tell you. And it's this, 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 and this. And they don't ask permission first, and they start doing a spontaneous reading without permission. Mm-hmm. That's violating. That's violating their sovereignty. Mm-hmm. They have a right to not know that if they don't want to.
Couple of other really good questions here. These two are related too. Is there a point where reincarnation reaches a climax and thus a new kind of existence or a new type of being results? And the question that came after that referred to where or what is the point of ascension. Do you have an opinion about those?
Well, ascension is a completely different subject, so let's not mix that in there.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what we said earlier, was that after you finish your incarnations and you have evolved to a certain point, back anymore.
Okay. Every now and then, you, for some reason, I don't know why, your mic cuts out, but so far yeah. we're doing okay with it. But
definitely, you're cutting out too for me, unfortunately.
Okay, well, we're just going to try and keep going with it.
Okay.
Couple more really good questions. I know our producer Joe's going to cut in here pretty soon and tell us that we've got a break that we're going to have to take, but I'm going to try and squeeze some of these in. Do you have an insight as to what happens during an instantaneous death where one doesn't have time to realize?
Instantaneous death?
Yeah, just boom, you're dead all of a sudden. Just an instant death, and you don't have time to realize what's going on.
There's a major misconception right there. Just because you die instantly doesn't mean you're not still there knowing what's going on. You know what's going on, whether you're inside the body or floating outside the body. You don't end when your body ends. Okay. You're floating outside your body, watching everything and knowing everything and drawing conclusions.
Okay.
See?
Good question and good answer to it.
Yeah.
That was very good. This is an interesting question. I don't think I've ever heard anyone ask this when we're talking about reincarnation. What are your opinions on euthanasia and results on reincarnation, both for the person who is asking for the assistance and the person who is helping them by providing it? What do you have to say about that?
Well, I would say that it, on a case-by-case basis, it depending on whether or not it is considered a suicide by the guardians of the records, it may or may not be considered a suicide, depending on the situation for that person. A suicide that's to avoid learning a lesson is something that you have to come back and repeat. Mm-hmm. But if it's just hideous pain and there's no, it's the last minute hideous pain and there's no value to it for the soul, then it's not considered wrong. Now, if you commit suicide just to avoid a situation that you initially came to learn a lesson from, when you get out of your body and go up to your guides, they go, you decided not to learn that lesson this time. I guess we're going to have to go back and learn it again later. But right now, let's go have some cookies and milk. They help you heal. They talk to you about, you know, well, you know, you wanted to learn this lesson, so going to rest up for a few years and then go back. And how would you like to learn that lesson? In other words, there is no judgment in the Akashic records.
And
there
I believe, go
no
ahead.
No judgment from the guardians of the records or your guides or anything else.
I think you've talked about checkpoints.
Checkout points,
yeah. Say something about what a checkout point is and why they come up.
That's kind of a long answer. Do you want to do that right now before the break?
Well, if you'll help me remember to do it after the break, I've still got I'm telling you, the chat room is on fire tonight. After we take our break, by the way, I'm going to give out the dial-up number, and we welcome anybody who wants to talk to Lois directly and ask questions to do that. How about, this is a really interesting question. Do you have any indications that support when people say souls are enticed here for an experience, but then they get trapped or prevented from attaining what it takes to go to the next level?
Well, I don't know who is telling that story, but it's pure horse hockey. Nobody gets enticed here. Everybody comes of their own free will.
Okay. Okay.
Nobody gets trapped here.
Here's another
good one. That sounds like fear porn.
Well, yeah, or someone
who... Not that the person writing it did it, but whoever told them that's creating fear porn.
Just trying to muddy the waters, maybe.
Oh, yeah, you betcha.
Here's another one before Joe catches me and tells me that we've got a break. How would the average person access the Akashic record for him or herself, or is that not even possible?
Sure it is. There's a woman named Linda Howe, Howe, who, not Moulton Howe, but just mm-hmm. Linda Howe, who has written a book on how you and a friend can get together and very carefully read her book, and then she teaches you in the book how to say a special prayer, and then, you know, your eyes are closed, and that's how you and a buddy can take turns. It takes two people. Can take turns getting, wait a minute, I think maybe you can do it by yourself. If you can believe what you see, I think it helps if there's another person there. But I think one person at a time, yeah. How to Read the Akashic Records is the name of the book.
And it would help for you to record that while you're doing it so you don't miss out on any of the detail, I would think.
It would, and that's why a friend sitting there writing notes would help. But if you have a recorder, yeah, do that too.
That's a great idea. I tell you what, Lois, Joe's given me the high sign here. We've got about 1 minute left. So let me remind everybody that you're listening to Epic Voyages online radio here at Inception Radio Network. And I'm Laurel Tague, and our guest tonight is Lois Wetzel. We're talking about her new book, her most recently released book, Reincarnation, Past Lives and the Akashic Records. And when we come back, please make a note of this number, 888-919-2355. Give us a call and talk to Lois directly. I've still got at least 10 or 12 questions here, and I'm sure more are going to come in over the break. So don't go away. Stick around for another couple of minutes. We'll be right back. And Lois, go get yourself an iced tea or something.
Alrighty then.
Okay.
You're listening to IRN, the Inception Radio Network, Chicago, Illinois.
Don't have a computer? Is your internet connection down? Don't worry. Use your trusty cell phone or landline and call into our listen line at 401-283-6700 to listen to the Inception Radio Network 24/7. Again, that call-in number is 401-283-6700. For the Inception Radio Network, I am MJ.
Hello, Inception Radio Network. Would you like your favorite show to be played again live on air? Well, now the choice is in your hands with IRN's live request portal, an easy way to request your favorite show with a simple click. IRN's live request portal now gives you exclusive access to all the shows. How easy is it? Simply type a show name or a guest name, click request, even write a dedication message, and that's it. Try it now. Simply visit InceptionRadioNetwork.com, click on the Live Request tab under the show menu. Now playing your favorite show is just a mouse click away. Hello, Inception Radio Network listeners. This is Amanda. Remember, you can take your Inception Radio shows on the go. Just download the Inception Radio Network app for your iPhone, iPad, or Android smartphones and access live shows, past shows, guest lineups, and much more. Just visit the iTunes Store or the Google Play Marketplace and download it today for free. You didn't forget what's coming up tonight, did you? Hi, Inception Radio Network listeners. This is Amanda. Never miss that interview you were looking forward to or the show on your favorite topic. Follow IRN on Twitter, I_R_N, and get reminders about the evening's live shows as well as fun and important updates throughout the week. That's I_R_N, and never miss a great show again.
Man vs. Archaeology with Aaron Judkins. It's about digging up the past, exposing forbidden archaeology, and discovering our hidden history. What are these mysteries of our past, and why are they important to our future? Learn more at AaronJudkins.com.
Howdy, this is Joe Mars. I'm inviting you to tune in to Epic Voyages, 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, Monday nights, right here on Inception Radio Network. To find out more about Epic and how you can become a member, visit EpicVoyagers.com. That's EpicVoyagers.com.
Well, welcome back, everybody, to Epic Voyages online radio here at Inception Radio Network. Our guest tonight is Lois Wetzel. We're talking about her most recently released book, Reincarnation, Past Lives and the Akashic Records. This is one of several books that Lois has written, and I am Laurel Tague. I am the New York State Director and the Vice President for Epic Voyagers. Ken Cherry, our president, is in the chat room here at Inception Radio Network. Be sure to go online and join us here. You can also make a note of our phone number for the show, 888-919-2355. 2355 and call in and ask Lois a question directly yourself, person to person. We've been talking about reincarnation and karma and all kinds of things. And I think this next hour we're going to get into talking about soul groups. So Lois, if you don't mind, I'm going to start off with a question here that leads right into one of my next questions. Do you have a theory as to the massive loss of souls during an event like World War II, where so many, many people are consumed? And are the many lost returned because of some sort of imbalance of an incomplete earth life, or maybe is it related to some other kind of a holocaust that happened in history? Or what would you have to say about that?
Well, the first thing I would say is that souls are never lost. People are, their bodies are, but their souls float right up out of their bodies and go back and have milk and cookies with their angels and their teachers and guides and then come back later. And yes, people do come back in groups. We have massive groups of people who, like the size of giant armies, who come back together in different time periods, which you know, and then they'll not incarnate for a while, and another massive army will come in during another time period. And these armies of people, souls, don't, it's just an organizational thing. They don't mix. And which is why, you know, I see certain time periods from these souls that we're with right now, and I don't see any from other time periods. And I used to think that was strange till I read Edgar Casey's book again on past lives, and he explained that there were these armies of people. And that's why I never see anything in these other periods of time.
That was my next question to you, because I think in your book you mentioned that you're seeing a lot of people right now in the last 20 years who have come in with large groups from Atlantis, Lemuria, and World War II.
Yeah. Yes, a whole lot of people have come back from who were you know, involved in World War II, and, you know, a lot of Nazi awful people, bear in mind their souls aren't awful, but the experiences they had were, came back as Jewish people this time. Mm-hmm. I've seen several of those. And they're very devout Jews, by the way. And they're learning a lesson of the flip side of what they were experiencing the last time. And let me say that the overriding principle here is that the Creator created all of this, all of us, so that he, she, it could learn more about itself. And every experience that we have informs the Creator about itself, because we are it. We are all part of it. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, yes, what happens now, pause, soak that in. What happens is that those of us who are here now, we're also, many, many, many of us, me included, in Atlantis, which, as everyone knows, due to technological errors, the entire continent went under the sea because they played around with stuff they should not have, dark matter, as a matter of fact. And there were two sides. One side said, leave it alone. And the other side said, no, we want the power and the glory, and we don't think it's going to cause a problem. And they caused a problem. And so they're back to learn that lesson. And some of them have come back as great spiritual teachers this time. Mm-hmm. And some of us have come back to facilitate the healing of that whole experience. That's what I'm here for, is just facilitate, to make sure that things happen right this time. So we're having some similar issues that are now resolved, but over the last 30 years that people like me were working really, really hard to make sure that we all survive, and we will. It's already in the ethers. It's already, the plan is set. It's settled, and now it's unfolding. People should not be afraid, because the world's not coming to an end. We are, it's already settled. in the outer planes. We have done what we needed to do. Mm-hmm. But groups of people come back together. Did I answer the question?
Yes, you did. And you actually just kind of skated on the next one I was going to ask you. And then I'm going to go back to the chat room questions. And remember, everybody, the phone number for dial-in is 888-919-2355. Do you happen to remember a lifetime of your own in any one of these periods, Atlantis or World War II?
Not World War II.
Okay.
Well, I'll take that back, yeah. I don't really like to talk about my past lives.
Okay, you don't have to, but you do remember that you were in those periods.
Yeah, I was a spy in World War II. I worked for the Americans, and I was born in Germany and came over as an infant. And home and spent the rest of my life in the service of my family didn't know it, but I was in service, as a spy.
Okay.
And died about 3 years, although lifetimes can overlap. Well, never mind. Then what did you say about Atlantis?
Yeah, do you have a memory of lifetimes when you were in Atlantis?
Several. One of the first past life I ever heard about when I got a reading before I realized that I could do them was in Atlantis. Yeah, I was a healer, and this is there have been several, but I will only talk about this one.
Okay.
And she was a female healer. In the healing temples, and everybody else was male. So she made some men in the healing temple mad, and when her protector went out of town, I mean, she made them really mad. She was the best diagnostician on the planet at the time, and they attacked and destroyed her. Long story short, didn't kill her, but destroyed her, so she couldn't work anymore out of envy. So there's that.
Wow. And it's probably, so, you know, I can well imagine that over many different lifetimes, some of the themes are the same.
Let me tell you what else. Part of what they did after they destroyed her so she couldn't work was they used her as breeding stock so that they could get some more of those people who were good at diagnostics, and she had 16 children, all of whom were taken away from her about the time they were weaned at 2 or 3 years of age. And
nice.
I lost 16 children like that, and I've met several of them in this lifetime.
Nice, really nice.
Not
well,
so
like,
much.
Like we said, it all comes back eventually. Here's a question from the chat room. Could a past life emerge somehow dominantly in the current life and then literally just take over or become a split personality or some other kind of disorder?
Yeah, that's kind of what we mentioned earlier, that with the young lady, that her past life bled through. And it might have looked like a split personality, but it was just that it was coming through and, it could.
Okay.
And I had a dream one time when I was in that metaphysical school and just beginning to learn about all this stuff back in the mid, and in that dream, I was driving a bus, and there were a lot of people in the bus behind me, and I was having a hard time driving. It was night, and one of them, a man, got up from the back and said, "Here, let me drive. I know how to do this." And I thought about it, and then I went, no, I better do this. So I told my teacher about it, and he said, "Oh, my God, you didn't let the guy get up and drive, did you?" And I went, "No." Why? And he goes, "Because those were past lives back there. You can't ever let them take over."
Oh.
And I went, "Oh, okay." I'm glad I didn't let the guy drive. It was tempting.
Gosh.
He looked big and strong, you know?
Wow.
Anyway, yeah.
Okay, here's another one. Like I told you, the chat room is on fire. I'm going to give out that phone number again, 888-919-2355 for anyone who's not in the chat room and wants to get in on the conversation here. Boy, the first part of this question is kind of difficult. I'm going to ask you the second part of it. Can our souls travel throughout the universe, and have you ever had a person speak an unknown language or claim to be from another world?
Well, I would be the person speaking the unknown language, and I've never done it. So,
okay.
What was the first part of the question?
Well, you actually have done readings with people that were not just like born and raised here on Earth, right? From people from other planets. I think I've read some of those who say, "I'm seeing you in a spaceship." Yeah.
Yeah, you can incarnate on another planet and then come here, and yeah, people do that all the time. A lot of people have done that.
Here's another one. What do you say about the nature of soul? S-O-U-L, soul.
What do I say about the nature of soul?
Uh-huh.
That's all that I heard was, what do you say about the nature of soul? Is there more to it than that?
No, that's it. In other words, we're talking about souls and what goes on past death. What do you feel is the nature of soul?
That's kind of such a broad question, I wouldn't even know where to begin. The nature of soul is love. I mean, it's pure love, just like the source is love, the source that created it. I'm not sure where to go from there. It's such a complicated...
It is kind of a huge question.
It is. It's like, what are people?
It's like one that. One that came up earlier, they were talking in the chat room about clones. And I know we've cloned sheep. Let's say we clone a human being. What are they going to have, like, I mean, I know that I'm going to, I don't mean this in a bad way, but this party line is that a soul decides where it's going to come in the next lifetime before its birth. Would that sort of thing happen with a clone that was being created in a lab?
You know, that's fleetingly passed across my mind before, and I can't say that I ever really came to an answer about that. I don't know. My guess would be that, yeah, if a body is created, it is ensouled.
Mm-hmm.
But...
how that would happen. I mean, my understanding is that in a normal way with two human beings, there's an attraction between the soul coming in and the soul that's actually, or the souls that are in that family that are creating the home for that. So I don't know how that would work with a test tube.
Well, who raises a child that's born in a test tube? People. But I mean, they're not going to turn. Okay, it would be just like an adopted child.
Okay.
The soul would come in with an intention of winding up with whoever it is that's going to raise them.
Okay.
An adopted child doesn't come in to be with, knowing it's going to be adopted, it's not going to come in to be with its birth parents when, in fact, it knows it's going to be adopted. It comes to be with the adoptive parents.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's very interesting that you said that. Seeing as how I was adopted by my dad, that's very interesting. Thank you for saying that.
I did not know that. I didn't know that.
Hmm. Here's another question. This is one of mine. I've gone from the chat room. I've got a few in the chat room, but I want to ask you one of mine. I know you're familiar with Sitchin and his work on Nibiru and Enki and Enlil and the stories of the genetic engineering of the human race and how Nibiru comes through here so many on an odd cycle, and it may be on the way here now. Have you done any readings at all that would make you think that Sitchin was onto something with his ideas? Or have you done any readings that pertain to any of the individuals that he wrote about in his books?
God, that's a good question.
Thank you.
I personally, and thank you for asking it, because it's making me, my wheels are turning here. When I first read Sitchin, I wasn't doing past life readings yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I just went, oh my God, this is awesome. I love this. I'm eating it up, hook, line, and sinker. And the older I get and the more I do this kind of work, the more I go, I don't think so. And now that you mention it, no, I've never seen anything that remotely indicates that any of that ever happened. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying I'm the final arbiter of truth in this situation, or that I'm the only one that's got that answer, but I've never seen it, and it doesn't resonate with me anymore at all.
I've seen a couple of places where you've talked about, I see you in something, it looks like a flying craft, and you're doing this, and you're doing that, but it was not connected with anything specific like the Anunnaki, or this was 250,000 years ago, or anything like that. So it even could have been in the future.
Well, it could be, but I would think they would tell me, but it could be. But no, I mean, lots of people have come here in spacecraft. I mean, they're coming here in spacecraft all the time anyway. But here's something that I saw briefly in the chat a long time ago, and I kept thinking, I want to answer that question. Somebody said, how long have human beings been here? And when I first started doing these readings, they told me at upward of 500,000 years, because they were telling me, okay, this happened 200,000 years ago. I'm going, what? These people have cars and airplanes or something similar to it, a spacecraft. And they're saying, so I'm going, finally one day I said, how long have people been here? And they said, over 500,000 years. And I'm going, no way. Well, since then, I've found pictures on the internet of people's feet in rocks that used to be mud with an overlay or an underlay of a dinosaur footprint.
Mm-hmm.
This is mentioned in the book as well. Also, last year in February, there were massive waves off the coast of England at Land's End on the far south and southwest. And these were 70-foot high waves, and they pulled all this debris off of some stuff that was under the water, but along the edge of the land, that were the footprints of an adult and several children, like six or seven children. And it was, they came over from the three different universities, Queen Mary College, I think was one of them, in England, and analyzed the sediment to see how old these footprints were. And they were 800,000 years old.
Wow. Wow. Well, there's a lot of alternative history writers now that are pointing to, I mean, 20 years ago, you were being pretty bold to suggest 10, 12,000, maybe 20,000 years back. But I've seen estimates of multiple civilizations that have come and gone with high technology, and they do go back several hundred thousand years, a couple of hundred thousand anyway. So that's very interesting. Let's just hope they're not all sitting in some kind of a warehouse at the Smithsonian, all the relics from it.
Oh, let me tell you, a whole bunch of them are sitting on shelves in the basements of museums, and they're calling it, well, I don't know what that is. It can't possibly be a battery, but it seems to be, but it couldn't possibly be. So just shelve it. We don't know what it is.
Here's another question from the chat room. Do pets reincarnate and follow a lineage of a particular owner? In other words, I guess it means if they are with you in one or two lifetimes, do they come back multiple lifetimes, the same pets?
I think they do.
I certainly would like to hope that that's true.
I've got a friend here in town who practices Wicca, and she's got a cat right now that she's had five different times. It's been five different bodies just in this lifetime.
Wow. Just in this lifetime of her own?
Yeah. The first one was Pie Wacket, but she keeps naming it. She goes, it's Pie Wacket again. But and she's had other cats and thought, why isn't Pie Wacket coming back? And finally, Pie Wacket came back again recently.
How funny. And of course, that's a wonderful name from Bell Book and Candle with Kim Novak. So here's another one. Do you believe in multidimensional experience, parallel universe, and can a soul go between those dimensions?
Somebody asked almost the same question earlier. Yes, there are parallel dimensions, and the soul may or may not go back in between them. I'm a little confused by that. It's taken bits and pieces of things that I don't really know how to answer that question.
Okay. We've got about a little over 35 minutes left, and I want to remind everybody that we're talking with Lois Wetzel here on Epic Voyages Online Radio at Inception Radio Network. Our dial-in number is 888-919-2355. We're talking about her recently released book, Reincarnation, Past Lives, and the Akashic Records, that you could find online through Kindle at Amazon.com. So I'm thinking, other than getting some more questions, I'm going to ask you a couple of kind of heavy questions that come out towards the end of your book, Lois. One is about instances where a person that you're doing a reading for has birthmarks or scars or some sort of a memory of being shot somewhere or a scar in a place where they were shot. And does that corroborate to a previous life? And the other question is your fascinating addendum at the very end of the book, which was too short. I think it was only 3 pages, where you talk about applications of quantum physics in the study of the paranormal. You can take either one of those first.
Well, let's see. The first one sounds easier to answer to me, but you're going to have to remind me what it was, because you got
there's been a lot of research on this recently about people who have a scar somewhere where their past lifetime they got shot or burned or cut or something.
Yeah, I personally had 3 scars on my body that correlate to a past life of an historic figure. And as I've gotten older, one of them has faded and gone completely away. But, yeah, that happens. Yeah, it's not uncommon. For example, a birthmark on somebody's back where they were stabbed with a broadsword. I've seen that actually in a family member. Mm-hmm. And it was removed. By, you know, the dermatologist, and the scar opened back up so that it was the exact same shape after the thing that they were worried might turn into a cancer, because it was on this person's back. The scar was the same shape, and it's there as a reminder of what happened to you. Now, the reason we have those reminders is so that people can come back and say, oh, yeah, that is so-and-so. Only we don't know how to do that anymore. And they do that a lot in, foreign countries.
India.
Tibet and so on. Yeah, that's how they identify you. Say, okay, is that so-and-so? And they say, oh, yeah, look, there's their scar. But it still happens.
They're very open to that whole thing in India and Tibet.
Yeah.
Way more
everywhere
so than we are.
Yeah. But this is relatively prevalent all over the planet. They're only a small percentage of the planet. There's only a small percentage of the planet that does not.
Okay.
This is not in the slightest bit uncommon to be born with. I'm trying to think of other examples.
Let me mention something here. I stumbled on the last few months. I've done 2 interviews with you about your books, and at least one other with a past life regression therapist. So I've been doing a lot of looking around on the internet, and I discovered a site called ISIS.net, IISIS.net, that's based on a lot of the work of Ian Stevenson. And there's a lot of information on that website. One of the researchers there is compiling instances where people now look, they physically resemble somebody in a past lifetime that they seem to have some sort of behavioral commonality with. One of the big stories on their website is about Anne Frank. So if anybody's interested in looking into that, and a lot of the stories have to do with scars and birthmarks and even missing limbs or paralyzed limbs. So you want to take a shot at the question on quantum physics?
Sure. What's your question?
Do you have a specific question? I wanted you to talk about what you said in your addendum of the book about how it applies in the study of the paranormal.
Okay, well, give me a second to scroll down and find that, because I don't have – the book's not in paper yet, so
– It's way at the back.
Yes, but it's not in the back in my computer.
Uh-oh.
Find it. I'm looking for it.
While you're scrolling down to it, let me give you a couple of more questions from the chat room. Do you think that reincarnations could occur in the form of time travel, with a person being projected far into the future and then comes back to a former time?
Yeah, I mean, when we reincarnate, we go back and forth in time.
Okay.
Time, it's there. Well, actually, let me get a little more specific with that. It's all happening at the same time. The linear quality of time is an illusion. In other words, from the viewpoint of the soul, it's all simultaneous. So, yeah, being incarnated 5,000 different places all at the same time in terms of the soul. So it's like there is no past and future. So.
Okay.
Pop around all the time. They go hither and thither in time.
Did you find your addendum?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. All right. What we talk about, first of all, is something I'm referring to several different people who are much more knowledgeable than I, scientists. And the first one I talk about is Deepak Chopra. And one of the things he has said that I've been thinking is that, you know, the scientific method just won't cut it in so many words. It's not big enough to explain everything that happens. It doesn't explain reincarnation. It doesn't explain psychic phenomena. It doesn't even explain what. So what Chopra says is that reality is too complex to be trapped by measurement. Now what he means by that is the scientific method is all about measuring things, and that's how they decide if something is true or not, is by measuring things. Do you want me to go ahead and just read the quantum conclusion and stop periodically and explain what it means?
Well, I guess if you're more comfortable doing that, I was kind of hoping you could just sort of highlight your own, the points of it that you really feel strongly about. But if you're more comfortable with reading it, go ahead.
Well, okay, let me do it this way. I agree with them that reality is too complex to be trapped in a measurement, because what the scientists do is that they, and many people know this and many people don't know this, the way they decide if something is real or not is they measure it. For example, they measure, they collect data, they analyze it statistically and decide if it's true or not. But that doesn't work for everything, because whatever you're measuring it with is not – it's a misconception that everything can be measured. Go ahead.
Well, it's a construct in and of itself. And if your construct doesn't match something else you need to measure, you're SOL. You're not going to be able to measure it.
Right. And what you're measuring with affects it. Mm-hmm. So are you measuring with a ruler? That's going to affect what you're measuring. Are you measuring with, a beaker or whatever with markings on the side? And but you're also, if you're observing it, you're going to be observing it with an instrument, because your body is also an instrument. And it's, you know, your eyeballs and your brain, those are all instruments. But the only thing that's left that's not an instrument is consciousness. And we know from the observer effect that consciousness affects the outcome of any experiment. So it isn't enough. So I don't know why I'm having trouble talking about this.
Well, I think it's a really complex deep
subject. It's very complex, and I don't really... Let me read this part, because... Okay, consciousness is all there is, really, ultimately. That in the end, that's all there is. Consciousness creates everything out of the infinite waves of probability floating out there in the unmanifest field. When I first learned about the famous double-slit experiment back in the 1980s, the experimenter's conclusion was that light could behave either as a particle or a wave, and whichever it decided to be was completely dependent on its being measured. And remember, the measurement, the measuring tools include your body, okay? Mm-hmm. Until it was measured or observed, it was neither a particle nor a wave, just a possibility. This decision light was making was referred to as the observer effect. Back then, the scientific measurement was considered the important event or deciding factor. I'm relieved to report that in the ensuing 30 years, more experiments have been done. And it's now known that not only light, but electrons behave the same way in this experiment. Electrons are little bits of matter. So with further experimentation, it's been found that molecules and atoms behave like waves of probability as well. This means that particles of matter do not decide when, where, and how they're going to show up in the physical world until they're observed. They do not exist as anything but a probability until consciousness interacts with them. And remember, consciousness is that thing that observes and floats up outside your body when you die, okay? Mm-hmm. It's not the body. Observation being so important, maybe it needs to be defined. Observation and measurement are the same thing. Measurement requires some kind of measuring device or tool. So one very important distinction about the measuring device is that it includes the physicality of the human being. The eyes, the retina on which images are registered, all that are just as much measuring tools as any other tool like metal and so on. So if the brain's just an instrument, then who or what's doing the observing? It must be something outside or apart from the brain. Clearly it has to be consciousness, since that's all that's left. In other words, when observation's broken down to its core component, all that is left is consciousness or awareness. In the end, that's all there is to do the observing, and hence the creating of reality, unconscious, is consciousness. And then studies have shown, well, I'm scrolling down too far, that something interesting happens when we decide to take an action, like picking up a writing tool, for example. Moves in the direction of the tool a fraction of a second before the changes in the brain, which signal that a decision's been made, have occurred. So yes, the hand moves before the brain thinks about picking up the tool. So clearly the hand, and doubtless other parts of the body, can receive signals from consciousness as well or better than the brain. The brain's therefore not where the decision's made. The brain's merely receiver. So the mind, or consciousness, is where the decision's made. The quantum physicist Nassim Haramein has said that looking for consciousness inside the brain is like looking for the announcer inside the radio. So to further support the existence of a separate consciousness, it's important to note certain facts that people who've died and revived have almost always report standing outside or floating above their own bodies. So even hospitals have written things on tops of cabinets in case people float up out of their bodies, and they can read it and then come back into their body so that they know. And that's their way of kind of testing it. And this happens. So if people can float up out of their body and then back into it, why couldn't they enter a different body? And why couldn't they do it more than once? I think it kind of indicates that we reincarnate.
Yeah, it leads you right to that possibility, at least, or at least you can't just reject it out of hand if you've gotten to that point.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So,
deep stuff to think about on a Monday night with the snow falling outside, I'll tell you that.
Yep.
Okay, I'm gonna go back to my questions here in the chat room.
All right.
Is there any benevolent or malevolent entity that interacts with souls before they reincarnate?
There are only benevolent entities. And I have known, however, of people who incarnated with dark entity attachments, mm-hmm. and they can affect their behaviors. And there are some people who know how to remove those things. And we're moving in the direction of there being fewer and fewer and fewer of those dark things on the planet. But yeah, it is possible. It's like,
that would be a bummer, total bummer.
Yeah, especially when you don't even know that's what it is.
Yeah. Well, this question, go ahead.
I removed one from a 9-month-old baby one time.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody, I was doing energy medicine, somebody brought in a 9-month-old baby that was just screaming all night long, and they had been since it was born. And so energy medicine is something you can do with the parent's permission with a child. So the mother was in the room and holding the baby, and I did a session on the baby, and there was clearly a really nasty, dark entity. And I wouldn't want anyone to draw the conclusion that the baby, their baby cries because they've got a demon on them, because mm-hmm. that's very rare. Had a really dark entity. I removed it, and it began sleeping through the night almost immediately.
And this was an entity that was on this side of reincarnating that attached itself, or it attached on the other side before it came in?
As it was coming in, it attached. There are some Yuck. That, like a curse, can follow people lifetime after lifetime after lifetime.
Oh, that's bad.
I don't like ending on a dark note like that.
Well,
but
we're not ending.
It's true.
We're not ending.
Okay.
Well, let's find our way out of it this way. This is kind of related, but we can go to a positive place. What happens to people who commit atrocities in their past lives? Could they change into a positive being, or do they just keep going on as an evil person?
Well, they have a choice. They always have a choice. And many, many, many times they do get better. They do get better, absolutely. And they're given many, many chances.
Do you think that some souls come back and intentionally, that they intend to be evil when they're coming back? I mean, can they just not get over that that urge?
That's a hard question to answer. I can't really. I wouldn't want to speak for those souls. I think if they're being allowed to come back, they have a spark of God left in them, and. They come back saying, yeah, I'm going to change my act. And then sometimes they're overwhelmed by that darkness. And then other times, finally, the spark goes out. And that energy, here's what happens. When somebody is given chance after chance after chance, and we're talking hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of chances to improve, and they just can't overcome it, and there's too much darkness. Again, there's no judgment, but these people are not put through, these souls are not put through it anymore, mm-hmm. and neither are those around them. And that energy is taken, and it's dismantled and reassembled in a different way, so that that soul is not reincarnating anymore, and its energy has been recycled.
Wow. That's an extreme case.
It is, but, you know, it's not sad. It's mm-hmm. because nothing ever ends, you know. E equals MC squared means that nothing ever really ends. It's just reassembled. Energy can't be destroyed.
Mm-hmm. Repurposed, sort of.
Yeah, it's like repurposing. It's like melting down a metal chair and turning it into a shovel. It's not bad. It's just different.
Mm-hmm. Well, a more positive way to invest that energy than it was.
Yeah. So, say, for example, it had been like a sword that kept cutting people and cutting people. And go, okay, this sword's never going to stop cutting people. So, let's melt it down and give it mercy and turn it into a bowl where it doesn't have any sharp edges.
Mm-hmm.
It's like that.
Here's a question I don't think I've ever heard before in this discussion of reincarnation, so I'm really interested in hearing what you have to say. Do you have any thoughts as to the pineal gland, and does it play any kind of role in the soul, the spirit, reincarnation, any of this?
My understanding is that that's where the soul comes in, is through the pineal gland. It's very critical. It's the most important part of your body. Yeah. That's why it's so important to take care of it and protect it and keep it clean. And part of that is by meditating, and another big piece of it is by not drinking fluoridated water. Hmm. It's where all your, it causes calcite crystals to grow on the pineal gland, and there are ways to get rid of it. Yep. Ugh. Keeps it from opening up, and there are ways you can get rid of it, and just Google, you know, calcite crystals on pineal gland. And there are all kinds of things out there now, ways to clean the pineal gland.
Wow.
I drink spring water.
Now, I noticed in the two books that you wrote about past lives that you have a little section in the back about apple cider vinegar. What is that about?
I learned this in that metaphysical school I mentioned in Houston called the Esoteric Philosophy Center, and it's been gone for a very long time, but I went there in the mid-80s. And he, the man that founded it, whose name was Elias de Mohan, he taught me a lot of stuff, but the one that I still use every single day is the apple cider vinegar bath. I'm either telling somebody about it or taking one of those baths. And here's what it's about, is anytime you go through a traumatic period, particularly when you're doing your spiritual work, if you will take an apple cider vinegar bath without adding anything else to the bath, no salts, no perfumes, no nothing, because it changes the chemistry if you do that.
Mm-hmm.
And you soak in, let's say you had a past life reading and it was a little traumatic and you're releasing emotionally, or you can do this after you have energy medicine as well. And if you're having emotional release, you fill a tub, nice warm bathtub, with water, and you put 2 or 3 cups of apple cider vinegar in it, and you soak for 20 to 30 minutes, minimum 20 minutes. And if you start to chill, then you add a little hot water, and, you know, listen to some music so you don't get antsy and get out of the tub. It will pull the emotions that you're trying to overcome. Say you're feeling angry, or you're feeling anxious or frightened, or, you know, your grief is coming up to be released. If you soak in the apple cider vinegar bath, it will pull the emotions out into your aura, into your auric field.
Mm-hmm.
And then you drain the tub and immediately take a shower. And what that does is rinses the emotions out into the drain. And if you don't shower, they settle back down into your body and you feel them all over again. Now, why do you want to get rid of them? Because they're uncomfortable. Emotions are important to feel in the moment that a thing occurs, but you don't need to feel it again when it's being released. It serves no purpose.
I don't guess it would work the same I'm thinking of people that have, say, shower stalls and they don't have baths. What if you were to do one of the old-fashioned sink baths or whatever, where you have it with warm apple cider vinegar and you just keep applying it in a cloth and then you get in the shower? Would that work, or do you have to soak
in it? No, you don't have to soak in it. But what I suggest is that you sit in the shower stall and either squirt apple cider vinegar and water onto your body. over and over, or have sit in the shower stall with a bowl of water with apple cider vinegar in it and sponge it over yourself over and over and over, and, you know, like every 2 or 3 minutes, and that'll pull it on out of your body.
Hmm. Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. So you recommend this to your clients after they've gotten your readings, and just in case they have a bad reaction?
In case they release emotion.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, I recommend it after any kind of, yeah, anything that causes an emotional release. The only thing I would say is don't do that to avoid feeling what's going on in your life at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
As a crutch. But yeah, anytime if you've heard about a past life and you've got emotions coming up about that life, rather than letting them spill over onto the people in your family or your surroundings, get rid of them with the apple cider vinegar. That's one of the many wonderful things it does for people.
Wow, who knew?
Yeah.
Well, we've got about, I'm guessing, about 6 or 7 minutes left. I'm going to give out the phone number one more time, 888-919-2355. Lois, we were talking about your website. I'm going to give that out again. It's hotpinklotus.com, HOTPINKLOTUS, hotpinklotus.com. And she has links there to her blog, which you can sign up for, her blog talk radio show. You also write for Sedona Journal under the name Lotus Fire, if anybody wants to check that out. And also your books on Amazon.com. Do you have any kind of speaking engagements or conferences you're going to in the near future?
No, not in the near future. I'm not doing the Blog Talk Radio show anymore. So okay. It's in archives. You can go listen to the archives. And I write for Sedona Journal about once a year these days. But I'm actively involved in Adena and initiating people remotely into the Adena energy medicine, and also doing past life readings and writing books. You know, I'm basically a teacher, and my intention is to use the books to teach as many people as possible. And soon I will be I've got a move in the works, and after I'm settled in the new place, I will begin teaching to do the past life readings like I do them. And I have taught a few people. Some people can do it and some can't. And so you just kind of have to know yourself well enough to know if you've got those kinds of abilities. And yeah, so the thing to do if you're interested in the classes is go to the website hotpinklotus.com, sign up for the newsletter. That is how I will notify people. I'm also on Twitter, and that is HPLotus, L-O-T-U-S, all one word, HPLotus. I invite you to follow me there. I am on Facebook, Lois Wetzel in Houston on Facebook, and I get on there and talk a lot. And there's the Akashic Records Readings.com blog, which I'm constantly posting past lives as they come in. And if I think one's really fascinating, I will ask the person if I can post it and their response to it with, you know, names and identifying information changed. Mm-hmm. And so you might want, if you check that, you will see there are a whole lot of interesting things on there already that are not in either one of my books. And there are some things that wound up in the books. But what I'm doing is constantly updating, sharing with some interesting past lives with the general public through the blog, and that's free. So again, that's AkashicRecordsReadings.com. And the For those of you who have just tuned in, the books are on Amazon and Kindle. Just Google my name, Lois J. Wetzel, W-E-T-Z-E-L. And the book that just was released on Kindle, September the 9th, is coming out, and I'm working on this right now, it's coming out in paper probably in the next week to 10 days.
Okay.
And it's 286 pages long. That's a long book.
Yes, it is.
When I thought, man, this seems like it's got a lot of words. And I did the word count, and I went, dang, this book's going to be almost 300 pages.
I know Joe's going to give me the high signal here in just a second to wind up. I'm going to ask you one more quick question from the chat room. First, I want to remind everybody that you're going to be back here as host in two more weeks, and you'll be talking to, you said, Dana Taylor?
Uh-huh. Dana Taylor.
Dana Taylor. A book called Ever-Flowing Streams. It sounded really interesting when you described it. So I will definitely put up on epicvoyagers.com some information about that. Joe's given me my warning here. So Lois, I want you to talk real quick on this. What are your thoughts on how healthy we keep our physical bodies and how that impacts our souls and spirits? And is there a correlation?
Well, I think the only correlation would be, as long as your body is healthy, you can focus on getting your work done and not be distracted by the illness, unless, of course, the soul has engineered an illness to learn a lesson from it. So, it's good to keep your body healthy so that your soul can stay in it, but I wouldn't say that, you know, healthiness is next to godliness or anything like that. I mean, the soul is immortal.
Yeah. But I think you're right. I think it is important to try to stay as clean inside and out as possible. And at that point, we're not going to talk about upper colonics. So that's going to be the end of that topic. Thank you, dear Hoof, in the chat room. Okay, it's time for us to wind up here. I want to thank everybody in the chat room and everybody for listening to Epic Voyages Radio. Lois, thank you so very much, and I will definitely be listening to your show here in two more weeks. And guys, check back with us next week. Aaron Judkins is going to be here. I'm not sure who the guest is yet, but I'm sure you want not to miss it. So good night, everybody, and have a wonderful week. And those of you up here around me in Western New York, go buy a snow shovel.
Thank you for being with us tonight. Please join us again next Monday evening for Extraordinary Phenomena Investigations Council's Epic Voyages. I'm Roger Peacock for Epic. Until next time.